tells. And of course, as it turns out, this cruel and unusual master ends up being cruel and unusual to the servant who buried his treasure or his talents. And the talent is not about our talents. It's a sum of money. It is a great sum of money. A great sum of money. All three of them are a great sum of money that the stewards have been entrusted with, the slaves have been entrusted with. So, here's my question. What do the talents represent? I'm going to let you actually answer that. We'll start with the choir because they're always ready. Traveling.
What is it? You were in church on Wednesday, you can't answer.
What do the talents represent? Anybody want to guess? It's okay, you don't have to.
Say that again.
What God has given you.
What God has given you. What has God given you for us? Salvation. Employment. Alright, let's ask the Queen. What do you believe that the talents represent? And you can't say what I said on Wednesday.
I didn't say I was saying Wednesday.
Alright, never mind. Who would like to answer that question? Yes, sir.
Ability.
Ability? Ability to do what?
To prosper. To prosper.
To prosper. Ability to prosper. Jane, come on. What do they represent?
I think it's ability to help other people.
Ability to help other people. Anybody else?
Family.
Family. Blessings. They're all blessings. So here's my take on it. Fact that I may have a different take. But if you think about it, what is the most valuable, beyond measure gift that God has given us?
Okay.
Life.
Life?
The love of God.
What's that?
The love of God.
The love of God? This isn't working. Well, as the children in Children's Chapel have learned, we do it for the preschool during the week, every answer is Jesus! And they get it right all the time. So, in my opinion, the talents represent the gospel of Jesus Christ. The talents represent what God has given us in Jesus Christ, which includes the blessings of family and the blessings of a job, the blessings of being a member of this church. But these last parables are really about what have you done with the gospel in the meantime? And the meantime is these latter days, as I might say at the Eucharistic prayer. We are in the latter days, and the challenge for us is what have we done with the gospel? Now, part of it might be how we've allowed God to work in our lives. That's part of the gospel. How is God working in our lives to give to the poor? To listen to other people. I attended a workshop yesterday with the Iona School, and part of the exercises, they sent us out to listen to people, not to talk to people, which was very difficult for me. So Laura Gilbert and I traveled, and we went into a local bar and had some good conversations, nothing to drink, and a Metro coffee shop. And part of what we heard, one of the questions was, where do you find God in Casper? Where is the spiritual center in Casper? And one of the things I heard was, it's where people gather, and it tended to be downtown from their perspective. But what struck me is, how in the world would I know that if I didn't ask and if I didn't listen? I think so often we are so full of our own understanding of spirituality, our own understanding of the gospel, that we don't take time to listen to what other people's experiences are. And our little group came up with a question that we'd want to ask in light of that, after we reflected on it, is go into the highways and byways and ask people, what do you think God is like? Let me try that right now. Jack, what do you think God is like?
Love.
Love. God is like love. It's a good answer. Now, let me ask you another question. Our follow-up question is, what would you like God to be like?
Compassionate.
What's that?
Compassionate.
Compassionate? I think one of the things I said, I don't know why this isn't working very well. I'd like to hear God's voice more often. I've heard God's voice before, but I just like to hear him every day. I pray every day, but I don't hear his voice every day. I'd like God to be more accessible, more understandable. Or other people responded, no more war. But God doesn't seem to work that way, does it? But it's something to think about, it's something to listen to. I don't know where I'm going with this. Why am I talking about this when I'm supposed to be talking about the talents? Oh yes, the gospel is the most valuable possession each of us have. Where are we investing the gospel? Where are we investing the gospel in our own lives? And where are we investing the gospel out there? Sometimes it might be by handing out diapers and food. But a lot of the time it may be by asking questions and listening to the answers. It is very difficult to listen to answers because you're thinking about what you're going to say next. Or you're anticipating their answer. Wow, what if we listened to each other's political views without having to respond or argue? What if we ask follow-up questions? Well, what does that mean? What does it mean that you want God to stop war? What does it mean that you want to hear God's voice more often? Maybe we should ask ourselves these questions. One thing's clear from this parable, and it echoes the parable of the ladies with the lamps that were not full of oil. And you'll hear another story next week. Maybe you will. Sheep and the goats. If we don't invest that gospel, if we just bury it, we may lose it. And it may be given to someone else who's willing to invest that gospel. I'm thinking as a church. Because I can tell you, as I've told the vestry, 20, 30 years from now, this will be a beautiful museum. If we don't invest the gospel in ourselves and in the world out there. Think about that. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.